So I haven't actually looked at any of this footage yet, like none of it. But based on yesterday and what I know about Georgia May and her pores, it's going to be a long one. So I'm going to keep this super duper short and just say right now, hello, I am Mrs. Soap and Clay. Let's make stuff. How's it going, Sudzers? Welcome back to the channel. You are at Soap and Clay, where we make all the soapy things, and you are here for day 304 of 365 days of soap, and we are doing Georgia May's attempt at the tall and skinny shimmy. Now, you saw my tall and skinny shimmy yesterday, wherein I was doing kind of like an ombre effect going on with all of it, and how I'd also changed the mold, although I don't really know that I explained that, so I will make sure that it gets explained in this video for sure, to change the dimensions of an existing mold to make it work for a tall and skinny shimmy. And yeah, today is Georgia May's turn. Now, she is using the same scent blend that I used yesterday, and this is the final test of the Nurture Soap blends that we got to, you know, do for the month of January. So we also get to talk about the final Nurture Soap review thing today. But as I said, I have not seen any of this footage yet. I am watching it load right now on the computer, and I don't exactly know what any of it is going to be. I will figure that out in the edit, but I'm going to tell you right now, because this will be edited into that, we should go check it out and we can talk about her pore there. Well, it is Georgia May's turn at the tall and skinny shimmy, which will be wrapping up our Amy Warden's soap challenge thing for the month of January. And that's cool. So far we have tested, this is the 10th scent from Nurture Soap that we've tested, and the 10th soap challenge that we've done, you know, in the month. So it's been cool. Now, it was using the same scent blend, the Avalon from Nurture, right? And it was, what were the notes? Let's check the website and find out. Right, so citrus, we got some apple, some violet, some peach, and a little bit of patchouli. It's a very interesting scent, for sure. And yesterday you saw in my bar that the end of it, it looked like freaking chlorophyll. Like, it's chlorophyll. And I'm actually wondering if we see any of that, like, any of that in Georgia May's pore as well for this. Because if we see some of that sort of like the variation that almost looked like there were a whole bunch of in the pot swirls, then I am going to err on the side of this was the fragrance that did this to this and not, you know, anything else. So it'll be fun to see that. Now, yesterday I talked about the tall and skinny shimmy and how it's very, very important to keep your batter really, really fluid, like essentially so fluid it just all falls out of your container without any real scraping required. And so I say that because I'm looking at Georgia May's batter right now and it already seems to be a little bit thick. And, you know, I actually think that's cool if her batter ends up being thick because, well, we can look at the tall and skinny shimmy and see whether or not that whole idea and that step of needing to make sure your batter is really, really fluid is actually a thing. Because, I mean, here's the thing with like all design pores, right? People have very strong opinions on the way something should be poured, right? But if you set out to do something like this, for example, for the tall and skinny shimmy, but don't keep your batter the right consistency or whatever, but it still becomes a tall and skinny shimmy, well, then the way that it's quote unquote supposed to be done doesn't really matter. Like, you found a way to make it work regardless. So I'm interested to see that. But yeah, so far that batter is already much thicker than it was, than mine was yesterday. I was soaping it like just barely almost at an emulsion. That's when I stopped and then, you know, took everything out and mixed it up and all of the things. Yes, and didn't have to scrape too terribly much from any of my beakers. All went out very, very fluid, but also very, very interesting in the final cut in that it looked like each of the individual layers were in the pot swirls that were then poured in. And you know, that's not what happened. The marbling was super cool and just a really interesting texture on that bar. So I, again, am curious to see if that's what goes down with Georgia May's as well. And her pour is going to be, I think, the exact same number of sections as mine. And she's obviously doing blues too, and so did I, but my blues ended up being kind of greeny blue, which was weird. But yeah, no, there's all of that. And Georgia May is always really great with the colors for blues and purples for sure. So, and those always tend to be the ones that they don't ever go the way that I want them to or the way that I envision it in my mind. And that might have more to do with the, actually, I don't know what that has to do with, because again, I taught her how to soap. So she usually keeps all of her micas and her, you know, oxides and ultramarines and all that well, well below the recommended usage rates for any of them. And so I don't really know. She's just better. She's just better. So there's that. And yeah, these will all get mixed up and colored and all that jazz. And then we are ready to move on to the pour stage. And that, those are a bunch of beautiful blues. I like that, and I like the little effect that she's going to be doing. I'm going to assume black on the bottom, moving progressively closer to, ending with white on the top. And yeah, this is exciting. But again, that soap batter is always already looking kind of thick. So let's go check out this pour and see what comes of, you know, all of these awesome blues, you know, when she starts scenting them and doing the things. So let's go check out that pour right now. And on to the pour of this guy. So she does have her mold set up on a slight angle. I think she has like a pen or a marker underneath it to prop it up right now. And yep, she is starting out with the black. And so she's going to scent every portion individually to give her more working time with everything and, you know, pour from there. So wow, that's cool. That's cool information. I'm actually just looking through the testing notes and all the things for the Avalon scent, and it's saying, you know, no acceleration, perfect pour. Same thing it said on the actual bottle. And I'm looking at the reviews, and you know what? There are actually a number of soaps that are posted in these pictures that I can see that sort of weird like striation thing in too. So that's interesting. I would actually be interested to know, for any soaper that's listening that has used this scent blend, this Avalon from Nurture before, did it achieve the, yeah, I definitely see what could be seen as like some, just like with the chlorophyll thing in a lot of these pictures, did it do that for you? And also, I mean, we're going to wait until the end of Georgia May's pour to determine whether or not it did it for her, because, you know, still have to get through the pour before we check the cut and do all the things. And yeah, I mean, her batter's reasonably well mixed within all of this. So there's no real variations as far as colors go in each beaker. But again, as you can see, really thick. It's pretty thick. So the whole idea of the dripping down beautifully and sort of like seeping or oozing, which are both two kind of gross words, to the middle right before you, you know, change the angle of the angle to pour the next round. It's not really happening the way that it's kind of meant to for a tall and skinny shimmy. Now, I also don't know. I don't remember. Yesterday, did I show you what I did to actually make this mold a tall and skinny shimmy? So I don't have a tall and skinny shimmy mold, but my bars already, they are 2.7 inches wide by 3.5 3 inches tall. So they're already kind of tall and skinny. And that's what this mold was built to the that bar size that I decided on. And so we didn't really need much to really turn it into a tall and skinny shimmy mold. And so what I did for this was I took a piece of cardboard on each side of the length of the mold and put it inside the mold, and then did the liner around it to take, and just taking off that essentially quarter of an inch of the from the width and adding it to therefore then the height, because we didn't change the batch size from normal batches. I think it should accomplish, I mean it did accomplish that yesterday. So George May is doing the exact same thing this time, and I don't remember if I talked about that or showed you the mold and how it was set up before. So now you know. And if I said it yesterday, then now I've said it twice. So there's that. And yeah, no, as she continues going on with this pour, I mean, nothing terrible is happening, right? Everything, it's all of her layers are still very much, all of her sections are still very much in the sections they're supposed to be in. But very, very thick batter. Incredibly thick batter. And as a result, it's not going to get the little swoopy thing. Or maybe it will. I mean, we will see. So, yeah, this particular pour, you can do a lot of really cool things with a tall and skinny shimmy. Like, you really can. And I think mine yesterday, it ended up looking like chlorophyll, like, you know, plant matter, like whatever. I found that really weirdly fitting because I set out to do a blue bar and I ended up with green notes. And then also with that, the variation, the texture inside of each of the sections totally looked like, you know, plant matter, like under a microscope. And that's very fitting for me. That was a nice happy accident. And so that was cool. And, with hers, like George May and the blues and the ocean and the things, and you know, I like that too. I think that totally makes sense. But yeah, as you can just really customize an individual and make a tall and skinny shimmies to really capture individual personalities or themes very, very easily. And at the end of the day, it's not a terrible pour. You know, it's longer than most pours that I do for my line. But also, this isn't something that I would say, no, I would never add a bar like this to my permanent line, because the process isn't terrible. It's not that bad. So it's no different than doing like a layered soap. And you know how much I like layers, but I still seem to have a crap ton of them in my line. So this would be one of the few challenges wherein I would say, yeah, no, you could just add this to your line and do this, you know, in bulk on a big scale. No problem whatsoever. I would not say that for like the teardrop or the rimmed soaps. The rimmed soaps, that's a... You don't want to produce those in bulk. That's a huge time suck. But this one, it's not a huge time suck. It's longer than most pours, but not terrible. So yeah, totally. This is one of the few challenges that are soap challenges from the Amy Warden Soap Challenge thing that are actually... not just about the beauty and the artistry, it's also functional, which I'm all about, because you know, I believe that soap is functional art, it's usable art, and that's cool. So anytime that we can do, you know, a beautiful bar of soap that doesn't take a ton of time but is still very striking and stunning, and also, you know, feels good on your skin and cleanses nicely and all the jazz, then yeah, winning all around for sure. But yeah, by the end of this pour, her batter's super duper thick. Like that's a lot of thickness for sure. I'm gonna actually have to ask her if she did the thing and actually like watched the tutorial, or if she just like did this intentionally. I don't know. I'm fascinated to see the cut. And I will, you know, be in to cut this bar tomorrow and do the things, so that's fun. I look forward to that. But for right now, she's putting in the very last layer of this, and I do not believe it's on any sort of... Oh, it was on a marker. Okay, so she had it propped, and then this is her final, you know, topping of the bar and doing the whatever, and she didn't leave herself much excess to do a pretty top, so I'm interested to see what she does here. I'm totally getting the Bob Ross vibes right now as she's laying this line down, aren't you? Like when she did the Bob Ross soap. She's an actual artist, and so she's deft with the palette knives and the brushes and all of the things and actually like painting and creating or whatever. But this is totally like an artist's touch that she's putting it just right there in the middle seam, or you know, one third seam or whatever, in between the two colors. She's using the little teeny tiny bit of soap that she has left to her advantage for sure. And that right there would be cool just to leave it like that. Honestly, like that's very cool looking. I want to do that for a soap top now. That's actually really cool. Let's see what she does with hers. Oh, the suspense. Oh, you can start seeing it. That's pretty. Oh my God, look at that. That's gorgeous. Those look like backwards music notes, or, I mean, in my head I'm going ribosomes, but that also doesn't feel right. But yeah, no, that's exciting. That's a very pretty soap top, and this will get put in the oven for CPOP and gel, and we will cut into it, you know, tomorrow. And on to the cut of this guy, and I cut this bar, and I knew I was going to have to because Georgia May was taking off for a few days, and so we wanted to cut it and get it as much air to it as quickly as possible so we can start its curing and all that jazz. And the bar itself looks great. It's very shiny, it's very smooth. I don't see any big holes anywhere from the pour, and so she did great with that for sure. And the top was absolutely gorgeous. Like, that was a really, really pretty top, and oh, see, that's delightful. That's lovely. It's like a cool landscape, like mountain-esque scene. That's gorgeous. But do you see in each of the sections there, you still have that? It looked like we did a dual color, a multicolor swirl in each of the individual things when we didn't. You saw that we didn't. So yeah, that's interesting. That is interesting for sure. Not nearly as big, but yeah, in that black part up down below, you can totally see some of the actual like texture variation in it, in addition to just the kind of color variation. It's not nearly as big and impactful as it was in mine, like as noticeable, but yeah, I think that's the fragrance that's doing that, which is super wild. It's gorgeous. It's super gorgeous. So I mean, that's actually something that I would file away and use the Avalon scent if I wanted like a quick and easy way to do some interesting color variations without having to actually do it in the pot swirl, because that's actually really cool. And that bar of soap, those are gorgeous bars for sure. Like, that looks great. It's not the full tall and skinny shimmy pattern that you want with a tall and skinny shimmy pour. Like, if you were going to be submitting this to the soap challenge, we don't have like the really nice rounded swoops between, but still absolutely gorgeous. Like, that is a beautiful bar of soap and it's one of those things. Again, you can start out doing the tall and skinny shimmy, and if it ends up like this, that's still a gorgeous bar that represents enough of the theme for, you know, something to keep in your line permanently, and that still works out. That's, yeah, I love that soap for sure. It's a very beautiful bar, and that top, I like the way that she did the top and sort of, it does this little swoop with the little like traily bits things going to the other side of the, into the white, but that's gorgeous. I love that for sure. And yeah, no, that's a nice bar of soap. Those are nice soaps all around. We only had that one little itty bitty hole that just seems to be showing up at basically the same place in every bar. But yeah, so not a lot of air pockets in this one, not much to clean up. But you know, when you cut your soap soft, you can just do that. Just clean them up right there with your feet, with your hands, fingers, things. Yeah. And don't pay attention to my hands. I had a fight with some primer. It's been a really weird week. Really 2 weeks. God, I'm tired of painting. But yeah, that's a beautiful bar of soap, like for sure. I love this one so much. This makes me super happy. Again, not exactly a tall and skinny shimmy challenge submission, but ended up being an incredibly pretty bar of soap regardless. And so still something to be incredibly proud of. So yeah, there's hers. And its gorgeousness, and there's mine and my chlorophyllness, and very, oh yeah, you put some, take some water to that and see those, that texture really stands out. It really pops out really weirdly. It's a wild, that's a wild bar, and they both sort of have it, mine more than hers, but that exists in both of them for sure. So I'm rather inclined to go with that's part of the scent blend, but scent blend is good and it smelled great and it was all awesome. So if you also get cool swirls, why not use the thing, do the thing. That is a day 304 Georgia May's tall and skinny soap challenge, Amy Warden's challenge thing attempt. So yeah, I mean, all things considered, maybe the swoops weren't exactly the way that they were supposed to go with hers, but it's still a gorgeous bar of soap for sure. And yeah, making sure the mold, like just adding just an extra piece of cardboard to either side of the mold and then putting your liner around that, it totally shrinks the bar this way enough to totally do a tall and skinny shimmy. So keep that in mind before you start thinking about like making or buying or whatever molds for this, because if this is not something that you're going to be doing all of the time, just modify your existing molds. It's much easier for sure. Now for the scent blend, yeah, the scent was good. I do think that we had a little bit of problems with this particular scent blend. Both of us experienced that, but across the board, we did 10 or 12 Nurture Soaps scents over the month of January, and they all performed basically the way that they said they were going to in the soaping notes. And so for that reason, you definitely get an A for accuracy, for sure. Good job, Nurture. For the soapability and the overall like scent throw after saponification, these are very potent scents. I approve, for sure. I have had a number of scent companies that I have loved the smell out of bottle. It's very powerful, it's very strong. And then after saponification, there's nothing left. And that was not the case for any of the ones that we tested this month. So good on you for that as well, Nurture Soap. Across the board, I actually think Nurture Soap makes pretty decent fragrances. So if you have not tried them, I suggest trying them. They did not give us any sort of problems that I would steer clear from in future pours. So yes, all around Nurture Soap, good job. If you are interested in the Tall and Skinny Shimmies, the last bar for, you know, the January soap challenges, you can totally find them on the website at soapandclay.com. They are available right now, mine from yesterday, Georgia May's from today. And yeah, if you are interested in more soapy antics and seeing who we review next month, because it's a new month, we're trying a new scent company for, you know, February that I've never worked with. And we have, of course, new bars, new challenges, new bombs, all of the things, subscribe to the channel. And then you can come back every day and see what we're up to. That would be awesome. For those of you who are subscribed to the channel, hey, thanks for coming back every day and seeing what we've been up to. It's always a lot. And I appreciate you for being here for all of the things and all of the allotness. Yes, I am out of here for today. I will see you guys all again for another round of 365 days of soap, you know, tomorrow. So, bye.